Because that's my issue, is that I played with Arcane the first time. Like, Arcane and some strength and skill, enough to use my weapons and stuff, but mostly Arcane. And I want to play it differently, but I just don't see how anything could be better than that. Like, it just almost seems like nothing else is worth playing. I know there's a lot of new blood tinge weapons in the DLC.
Ew. Welcome, everybody, to the Damage Per Second podcast this week. It's week 12, I believe. The topic this week is going to be cooperative games, our experience with cooperative games, what we think makes a good cooperative game and what doesn't. I'm here with Brett and Keith.
Hello, I'm Brett.
I'm Keith.
I'm Keith. Oh, I'm sorry, wait.
I'm Justin. Hey!
So, what have we all been playing this week? I'm going to go first because I'm actually playing XCOM right now. I feel like I've made the full transition, and if you've been a follower of the Damage Per Second podcast since its inception, you would know that for a long time I've just been saying how much I really, really don't like turn-based games, and it took me about a week, and I feel like I had to force myself to enjoy it, and now I do enjoy it.
That's good.
I did exactly what I thought I had to do, which was hate it for about a week, and now I'm totally into it. So thank you for, I suppose, forcing me to give it a shot.
Such a great game.
It is. It's really fun. I mean, it feels not really unfair, but just kind of silly sometimes with some of the stuff that happens. And a lot of it is like incredibly unexplained.
Yeah.
With like some of the mechanics. And it's like last week we were talking about, you know, things like that where some mechanics can be unexplained and like the fun of it is kind of figuring it out. But then at the same time, it feels like some stuff is sort of essential to know.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of that in this game that is just completely unexplained that feels kind of essential.
That's the one thing is, like, you want it to be kind of forgiving if it's going to be like that. And XCOM, you can just ruin your entire game based on what you do or don't do at the beginning of the game.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. That's a great
way to put it. Totally ruin and then not be able to finish it.
Yeah.
Yes. That's an excellent, excellent way to... That took the words right out of my mouth, Keith.
I mean, it's so easy to, like, restart the game.
Oh, my God, I'm sorry.
And kind of, I feel like kind of the fun is failing one or two times. And then once you finally figure out the right way to play the game, it feels really good. You feel like you've learned something.
Yeah.
But it's frustrating, like, on the way. So.
I mean, I don't know how close I am to the end. I feel like I'm probably close, but I'm not sure.
Yeah.
So if I am close, that means that it is a relatively short game. I feel like it's kind of supposed to be a relatively short game.
Yeah, it's not really long. I think you're supposed to play it a bunch of times.
Yeah. Well, I'm excited to get into to the second one, and I noticed Dimbass is bringing up Darkest Dungeon. And yes, that's on my Steam wish list. I'm probably going to buy it. I've had it on my wish list, and I've been thinking, I'm not going to buy this until I either, unless I put the nail in the coffin once for all that I definitely hate these kinds of games, or I think I'll enjoy it. And I'm pretty sure I'd enjoy it now, so I'm going to stick with it.
Good.
But that's pretty much all I've been playing this week. I've sort of neglected recording for my channel because I've been so interested in keeping it going.
Yeah.
Well, you've been good about streaming, though.
Yeah, my internet's been being wonky, though. That's I asked if one of y'all wanted to stream tonight just because it's been so shitty, but it's all right. It's going pretty well. What about you guys? What have you been playing?
Why don't you go? There you go, Brett.
Damn it!
No, alright, so what I've been playing is, did a little bit of Fallout, and then I have been doing, we played some co-op games more than last week. We played some Rocket League this weekend, and getting better, but still not really very good. I mean, we still haven't done the training, so we're probably going to do that eventually. And then we did some more Helldivers for the PS4, twin stick shooter, and that's getting more fun. There was a little dip where I was like, oh, these missions are the same, but now we're starting to get into some new style missions, and they're at least very challenging, and we're getting better, and that makes it kind of more fun, unlocking new things and that kind of stuff, new weapons, upgrading them. So that's pretty fun. There's a lot of stuff in there that I don't really understand, like, oh, your influence level in certain planetary systems. And it seems like And they'll say, like, you got 2 community influence. And then they have, like, a bar that's, like, apparently you're supposed to try to fill it, I assume. And then it just, like, shows your contribution adding to it. And then the bar just doesn't move at all. So I presume that's, like, something that everybody on the internet, like, the whole community is kind of involved in. They really wanted to, I think, give it kind of a unique online perspective. Because I think random people can join your game online. Mm-hmm. Without you even, like, inviting them. And you can put down items that'll increase the odds to summon one of these people and stuff like that. And then you can also, like, when you're orbiting the system, you can see the other players' ships with their names above them. So you're like, oh. So they're really trying to integrate the online play. But I like the couch co-op part the best.
Hey.
So we don't really want people to join most of the time. So I guess that's an issue. But, yeah, you can play online if you want to. And then we were doing some co-op Binding of Isaac again for the first time in a long time. Like, for the first time since Rebirth came out. A bunch of other updates have come out since then. And when we left it originally, we were like, this is fun. And it's fun because we, instead of switching off every floor, you know, we both play all the time. However, I think Edmund McMillan may have been a little bit too overeager, as he talked about in some interviews before the game came out. Like, he didn't want to make co-op overpowered. He didn't want to make it overpowered. But I think he went a little bit too far in the opposite direction. With 2 people on the screen, you're more likely to get hit. They have the damage you do. You take a heart or more away from the main person. So in no way do you have an advantage, you know, damage-wise, health-wise. And I think that's really as far as you need to go. Because right there, you already don't have an advantage. But then on top of that, with the 2 people on the map, you are much more likely to get hit. The enemies are more unpredictable because they're not always going to be following the same person. I mean, you're not always going to be focusing down the same enemy, so there's going to be more enemies longer on the screen. And so there's just things like that that end up making it harder when you have 2 people.
Yep.
But and then you unlock these new, you unlock special babies that have interesting abilities, and that's really, really cool. Like, a lot of the unlocks late in the game are exclusively devoted to unlocking these special babies. Like, 10 of the biggest, like, or I, more than that, like, probably 14 of the biggest unlocks at the end of the game are these special babies. But unless you play co-op, you're never going to see them. And then there's, like, 200 babies. So the odds that you're going to get any of them are extremely low anyway.
Yes.
So that's sort of my issue with it. But they've done a lot to fix that, to remedy that. You get, like, at the start of a run, it randomly gives you, like, 5 babies that you can choose from. And they tend to be more of the special babies that you've unlocked. So you get to actually try them out. And some of them are really cool. And as you die as them, you don't get to use them anymore. And you can always pick a random baby. Like, you'll be able to do that an unlimited amount of times. But that was super, super fun. It made it way better. I felt like I was helping. Like, previously, when we'd get to a really hard boss, you know, I would just disappear and give Jen her damage and life back, or vice versa, because one of us had a better chance to beat the boss than both of us together.
Mm-hmm.
And now I don't feel that way. And I got, you know, you'd get a baby like Psy baby who has homing shots, or babies that occasionally give the main player, you know, a bonus, or they drop, you know, they have coin tiers. The enemies occasionally drop coins. Or I got the, I think you get it from beating with either Eden or the Lost, and it's like 0 baby or something like that, and they literally take 0 damage.
What the?
So you can play in a totally different way, and you can run up close. So I was like blocking shots that were going at Jen and stuff like that,
mm-hmm.
just soaking them up so that she wouldn't get hit. And it's way more fun now if you guys haven't played co-op in a while. And another thing, if you haven't, if you think, well, I can only do that on the PS4 or Xbox or something like that, no, you can actually do it on the PC. I'm not sure if they have separate mappings on the keyboard, but you can plug a controller in, and you don't need motion enjoy or anything. You can plug a PS4 controller, Xbox controller into your USB and just start up the game and play two player.
Yeah, I have. Tara and I have done that a couple times, actually. You can do it with multiplayer. I just had controllers. You just plug in two controllers and you can play, or one person can play on the keyboard and the other person can play on a controller, which is pretty nice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. So I know I had a lot to say about that, but I had a really good time with that this weekend.
Mm-hmm. I think that's interesting because it fits into the topic in an interesting way, because you think about what I guess we should save this, but you're talking about what makes it like too overpowered or underpowered, because from the game designer's perspective, he thinks, oh, it'll be overpowered because there's two people on the screen. But there's some situations where, in fact, it's harder when there's two people on the screen, especially in bullet 100%. Hell type games, you know?
Yeah, yeah, bullet hell. Like, you're just literally twice as likely to get hit. Oh, another thing. They used to have it so where if you had one of those large, extra large rooms and the other player moved, it would just drag the second player around the room. So they, would just get dragged into fire and other enemies and all kinds. I don't know. There are all kinds of situations where you were just way more likely to take damage if you had two players.
Yeah. All right, Brett, what have you been up to?
Playing some Bloodborne, you know. But in general, I've actually been playing a lot of Street Fighter V still, which is good, and it's not totally broken. They did a 3-hour server maintenance, which actually was funny because they decided to tweet that the server maintenance would last, like, I think they said indefinitely or something. Like, it started, oh, we're going to have a 2-hour maintenance. So everybody's like, all right. And then there's three following tweets that were like, we're going to delay it 1 hour. And so everybody's like, well, this sucks. And then they just say that it was going to be indefinite. But then it ended up being just another hour. I guess they just were sick of saying the same thing over and over.
I kind of like that, though, with, like, they're just being straight up like, look, something went wrong. This is going to take forever.
Yeah. Yeah, no.
Like, just to be safe. This is going to take a really long time.
Something must have really went wrong.
Yeah.
As people who work in sort of IT like situations, you know, whether it's supporting some software or something like that, you never know how long it's going to take. And people always demand, like, well, how long? And, like, they'll give you a number probably. The real answer is we have no fucking idea.
Yeah. Right, right.
We could guess, and then you'll get real pissed when we're not right.
I just feel like when you go in to fix something, there's going to be, like, three other things that probably break on the way. I'm assuming that's what happened.
Yeah. I mean, the only thing is, when you think of a game that is, it's been released, that's my only kind of issue, is when you have a game that's fully released, maintenance should be scheduled and not, I don't know, it's just my opinion, like, they shouldn't. You shouldn't be experiencing problems. The game, it just goes to support this idea that the game was released prematurely and their infrastructure clearly was not ready, and or there were some bugs within the software development that should have been sort of caught at least partially before the release. And if you ever run into a situation where it says, okay, indefinite maintenance, that might happen maybe like right after a big patch or something like that. But generally... It kind of harkens back to, like, the Diablo 3 release, where, like, everything just went wrong right away. And you think it was because, you know, the population on the servers was too high or they just weren't ready. And I think there's a lot of cases where games are rushed and aren't ready, probably because they are rushed and not ready. Oh, and everyone's like, what's going on? And it's clear, like, it was rushed.
Yeah, it's pretty well known that this game was rushed because of the fact that the Capcom Pro Tour, which is their big selling point. I think I talked about this last week, but, I mean, people had to practice for it, and it was this weekend, so, you know, if the game wasn't out, how are they supposed to hold the competition?
Yes.
So, I mean, people know that it was rushed, and I don't know if people are over it or not yet. I'm over it. Like, I'm enjoying the game a lot. I'm having fun practicing and learning. It's really cool to learn a new game, and it's hard and frustrating, but it's also rewarding.
Mm-hmm. Would you say that people are more or less angry about this than they were about Diablo 3 at launch?
I mean, I don't know. I've kind of, like, selectively looked at things where people are, like, going to defend the game anyways. But perusing NeoGAF, the forum, I feel like there was a lot of threads trying to just bash the game for any little wrong thing that it did. Like, oh, it sold less copies than Street Fighter 4 did on launch on the PS4 in England. It's like, all right, come on. Are you really trying that hard to disparage this game? Like, I don't know. People just aren't giving it time. Like, the franchise is such a staple for, like, fighting games. I don't understand. It's pretty self-sufficient, I feel, at this point.
Well, I also think that Diablo 3 launch was different in the sense that the launch caused problems, but I think people got over the launch relatively quick. The bigger issue was the way that the loot tables worked and the auction house, which weren't necessarily problems with the launch. So I'm not sure, you know, what was really considered to be the bigger issue and what was considered like launch. Because obviously, and it was the same with the most recent World of Warcraft expansion too, there's always problems when there's big patches and expansions with Blizzard games because of the amount of people trying to play and having infrastructure that can support that many people. It seems like they never plan correctly. Very rarely does something go right. I think the Legacy of the Void launch went all right, but that's probably their least played game. And I don't know. I think the D3 thing, like, it was easy for people to transition and be like, well, this game's launch sucks. Oh, it's working now, but the loot tables are terrible and I never get anything that I want and everything for all these other classes drops and they're forcing me to use the auction house and pay real money. So it was like a nice, easy transition for people to think back on the launch and think it was all a problem with the launch as opposed to core problems with the game.
Yeah. And I think that's the interesting part of Street Fighter V is I think eventually the core game is going to be amazing. But it's all just launch issues, like server issues. And I've had issues with, like, the balancing of the way that they match you with people online. Like, there's an MMR system, and so I'm getting matched with people with, like, 1,000 more points than I have. And it's like, oh my gosh. There's no way to learn when somebody's just destroying you. But yeah, it's a really fun game so far. They could have more single-player content, but I'm having a ton of fun with the multiplayer, which is where I'm going to spend 90% of my time. Anyways.
Cool.
So, yeah, that's about it. Pretty much all I've been playing.
I started
Wind Waker, too, I guess.
Oh, yeah, I mean, you've been blazing through Wind Waker. I've been watching you on your stream. It seems like you've gotten really far in a very short amount of time.
Kind of. I mean, if you think about it, it's like, I compare, like, getting the Master Sword in this game to, like, getting the Master Sword in Ocarina of Time. Like, it's kind of like that same amount of time. So I don't know. There's only two dungeons.
I've
done it many times though, so.
I don't want to say rumors, but wasn't it said, I'm not sure if this is true or if it's just a rumor, were there supposed to be more temples in that game and then they were canceled, or is that just something people say because they assume there should have been more temples?
I'm pretty sure there was, because I mean, you look at how they handled the third orb that you're supposed to get in the beginning.
Yeah.
I mean, they have you go through two dungeons with, like, good reasons for why you need to help these people and get the orbs. And then the third one is like, hey, I'm a big whale. Here's the orb. And it's like, all right. That's stupid. And then I think there's some part of it in the end of the game, too, where there's supposed to be more dungeons. I'm not really sure. I don't know the factual evidence, but, I mean, it just seems as though there are parts.
And that's the thing. I'm not trying to like grill you on it, because I'm just curious, because I've heard people say the same thing, basically saying it seems like there should have been more dungeons, but were there actually more dungeons that were canceled? Nobody seems to be sure. And I think the thing with, like, the whale, where Jabin or whatever his name is gives you the pearl, I always figured, the way I always saw it was that the dungeon was where you had to go onto Windfall Island and sneak onto the pirate ship and all that kind of stuff. I always saw that as like a mini dungeon almost.
I guess that's fair. Oh.
But what do I know? I'm just a piece of shit. What?
Well, I didn't want to be the one to say it.
But yeah, I'm loving that game again, though. I've played it so many times now, but after Majora's Mask, it's such a breath of fresh air. And the improvement from the N64 to the Wii U is pretty wild, too, since I've been playing them in succession.
Mm-hmm.
And Twilight Princess comes out Friday, so that'll be fun to get into. Gotta beat Wind Waker soon.
Nice.
So, yeah.
I think on just kind of on the same topic of what we've been playing, talking about XCOM, and I think this is the first game in a while that I've played. This is kind of depressing, but the first game in a while that I've played where like I want to stay up late and keep playing it. That doesn't, I just don't get that anymore. And with this game, I kind of have it again. It's nice.
Nice.
I don't know.
Real nice.
Real nice.
Yeah, there have been times in the past when I have thought like, yeah, I'm not really like addicted to video games anymore. Like I don't really have that kind of like, you know, that, like game addiction where I can't stop. And I'll find a certain game and I'll be like, nope, it's still there.
Yeah, all exactly.
Right. Holy crap. Dark Souls is like any time a new Dark Souls game comes out.
I know, like the concept of being addicted to video games has always been kind of weird to me because I've known that it's not about being addicted to like the concept of video games, but like there are certain games that will just invade my mind and never leave.
Exactly.
Stop playing. Like I'm not gonna be like, oh, I've got to play Mickey Mouse Racing because I need a video game right now. I'm shaking. Like it's not like that. Like
Mickey Mouse Racing, huh?
Yeah. So I don't know. It's just funny.
I don't know. It's like it's something that it makes me feel. I hate to use the phrase like a kid again, but I just remember like in college where you'd stay up till like 2 or 3 in the morning wanting to play games just because you found one and you're just so into it and it's so fun. Yeah. And this is how I feel again. Like I've been staying up kind of later, just playing this game. And hasn't really been a game like that for a long time except Legacy of the Void, which I purposefully stayed up really really late to play on release. But that was it. I don't know. It's a fun feeling that I feel like I had lost over quite a long period of time, but now it's back again just with this one game. And what's nice about it though, and the reason why I'm kind of excited about it and being sappy about it now is because I feel like this is a whole new genre that I have been seduced by, and there's so many other games now that I can try and enjoy because of it.
Well, they're not all as good as XCOM. So.
Yeah, right.
Fire Emblem's pretty cool if you want to try that. It's pretty similar. I just like the ability to create your characters, and the character creation in XCOM 2 is very in depth. So you get to like really, you get to create your soldiers and like say what they look like and all this good stuff. So it helps the attachment factor.
That's cool.
You should play on Iron Man as well.
Well, that's the other thing, and I don't know if I don't think I brought this up last week because I had talked about the same thing last week about XCOM, but now like I'm super into it, and I'm not very good at it. I should point out, I'm very bad at it still. But the thing about Iron Man is I'm really tempted to save scum all the time, and because I've got reliant on it to an extent, I play carelessly, which doesn't allow me to get any better at the game, I think.
Yeah.
So I think I need to like force my. I feel like the thing about Iron Man is it forces you to play a specific way. And I kind of like that. I need like some sort of mechanism in place to force me to not just save and reload to try different things. I'm like, I really want to capture this alien. There's got to be some combination of moves that would allow me to do it, and I'll just keep reloading until I figure it out. And I feel like that kind of takes away from part of what the fun of the game could be.
That's how I feel. I mean, like, I'm going to do whatever I can possibly do to break your game and, like, make myself really good and overpower myself, but I don't want you to let me do that. And that's, like, what a game is to me, you know? So, yeah, I almost feel like I need to... I mean, I guess I play Dark Souls and don't really mind it, and that... you know, saves automatically and you can lose shit. So, yeah, I guess you can't quite lose stuff as bad as you can in XCOM, but...
I think XCOM is different because you are kind of meant to. Like, that's a core part of the game, I think, where there's less consequences. There's fewer consequences, I think, for dying because it's an integrated part of the game where, you know, dying isn't... It's not the end of the world, I suppose. Like, you lose humanity, right? But that's... mostly it, and you're meant to learn and retry, and that's kind of the charm of the game.
Yeah.
Whereas XCOM, you know, something goes wrong and you lose two of your best soldiers and you are just severely punished for the rest of the length of the entire game, basically.
Oh, shit. Sorry.
Yeah. Now, you know, speaking of Dark Souls, you know, I wanted to, you know, take this opportunity to announce and everybody in your chat, they've been... Everybody's been wondering. They've been saying, "Hey, is Keith gonna pre-order Dark Souls 3.
Everybody's been saying it.
It's all they can talk about. They've been saying, is he going to pre-order it? And if he's going to pre-order it, is he going to pre-order it on PC or PS4? Everybody's waiting to hear about it so they can decide which platform am I going to get it for? Because which one's Keith going to be playing it on? So I wanted to take this opportunity to announce that I'm going to be pre-ordering it for PC.
Nice.
It was a tough decision, but what it came down to is that, like, I can play it when the family room's taken, all right? You know, with the roommate. I can play it at a little bit higher graphical settings, hopefully not locked to, you know, 30 FPS, although I haven't minded it too much, 30 FPS lock for Bloodborne on the PS4. And I guess if I ever decide not to have a PlayStation Plus membership, which I'm not, I'll probably just have one anyway, but if I ever decide not to, then I'll still be able to play it online.
That's smart. Good thinking.
Congratulations, Keith.
But the con is that a lot of my friends are getting it for the PS4, I think, so that's rough.
That's okay. I'll probably get it on PC eventually.
Yeah.
Whenever I upgrade my computer, which is not on the horizon or anything, but it'll happen.
I'm generally not like a PC Master Race kind of guy. I don't know. I just still feel, though, like it makes sense. If you have a PC that can run newer games, it just feels like the better choice because you generally have more graphical options. I'm not saying that every game always looks better and is better on PC, but in general, on average, rather, you tend to have more options on PC in terms of, you know, visual effects. So
the interesting thing is that Dark Souls 1 was kind of shitty on PC until, like, some random person patched it.
Right.
And then made it amazing. You're like, why the fuck couldn't they have done that?
Yeah.
Yep.
That's actually one of the reasons. There's Dark Souls is another series where I feel like it's kind of like XCOM, where I feel slightly discouraged with it. Well, I bought the Prepare to Die edition for the original Dark Souls, and then I never played it because I heard all these bad things about the PC edition, so I just sort of never played it then because I got like semi-discouraged because I thought like, well, apparently this game isn't very good, so I'm just not gonna do it, or I'm not gonna play it, which I think was probably a mistake in retrospect. But
it's like the stigma hangs around even after the issues have been fixed.
Well, I feel like the issues haven't quite been fixed considering it's like a user-made mod. Is it patched into the game? Or is it something
you have to download it yet?
Okay. Yeah. I mean, that's not a big deal, but like, for a game that I'm sort of on the fence about from the beginning, that just sort of was like, well, I guess I'm not playing this. At least that's how I kind of went about my thinking of it, which is looking for a reason to not play it.
Yeah. There's some rare bugs in the modded version or something, like, oh, because, you know, oh, you know what? You know what's hilarious is that even Dark Souls 2 had huge issues with the PC version. So this is like, yeah, and here's what happened. And it was another thing where it was just like really regrettable the way they kind of pushed, you know, like they didn't, I was going to say pass the buck, but they didn't pass the buck. They didn't like blame someone else or something. They just said, no, it's a feature. It's supposed to be like that. And the problem was that you were on, you know, the consoles are locked to 30 frames per second, right? And the PC version, it wasn't 30 frames per second. It would be, you know, 45 frames per second or 60 frames per second, depending on how good your, you know, machine was. And so in addition to a number of, you know, smaller issues, the biggest issue of all, well, so certain animations were based on how many frames there were. So the enemies would, like, be flying around the map really fast, and you don't really know better. You're playing, and you're like, holy shit, these enemies are just, like, blasting across the screen and killing me with a katana. What the fuck's happening? And what it was is that the enemies are moving twice the normal speed they're supposed to be moving because certain animations are just locked to the number of frames for whatever reason. So 6 frames happen much faster if you're doing 60 frames. I mean, it happens twice as fast. And the second thing was your durability for weapons were based on frames. It's like, oh, you lose one durability or like a half a durability for every frame that it spends inside the enemy or another object. And So if you're swinging at a normal rate and it's running at 60 frames per second instead of 30 frames per second, then you lose durability twice as fast.
Mm-hmm.
And they just denied it. And they were like, nope, it's not a problem. And then people would like show side-by-side like GIFs of PS4 and PC and like the durability and everything. It was like so proven. And they're just like, nope. Nope, it's supposed to be like that. And I mean, so that was the thing that I think pissed people off the most, is that like it was still very playable, but it was just bullshit. Like they just lied,
yeah.
And I don't think they ever fixed it. It's another thing where I think someone just stuck out a mod, and finally fixed it, but it's crazy.
Yeesh.
It's almost as if they just don't like know how to code on the PC or something, and they just have someone port it over, and just any problems, just they just happen. If it happens, it happens.
I think Dark Souls, I mean, the first Dark Souls was definitely, like, it was very widely known to have been rushed, because there was, like, a huge demand for it. Like, I think the developers didn't know, there was, like, some representative in the company that was like, oh, you guys want this on PC? And everyone was like, yes! Like, way louder than
yeah.
I think they expected. So, like, fuck, we need a PC port immediately. And then they rushed one out, and I think it just, they didn't port it very well. They probably didn't test it very well. And that's what happened.
Yeah. So, yeah, that being, so obviously, then I'm getting Dark Souls 3 on PC. Great ideas, right?
Well, the second one on PC apparently was much better, right?
Well, the
second one was the one that had the durability problem.
And oh, okay.
The animation problem. Like, but, it wasn't as bad as Dark Souls 1, where you just couldn't play at the higher frame rates, and so yeah, but it was still pretty it's conceivable that you could have played through the game without noticing it, you know what I mean? Like, you'd be like, holy shit, these enemies are hard, but you could get past them.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I don't know, and you're like, boy, my weapons are really just like, I feel like I'm repairing this thing all the time. I guess it's just, you know, it's made the game harder.
Cool. Well, I suppose we should talk about the topic.
Oh, yeah.
Which is co-op.
I forgot about that.
Was it? It was co-op, right?
Yeah.
So, I guess what I want to ask, rather than being like, let's just talk about co-op stuff, tell us about a co-op game from when you were younger that you found was just incredible and kind of, it lives on, like, couch co-op in your mind is like the best thing ever. And then is there anything that, I mean, there's a lot of co-op these days, but is there anything that kind of captures that anymore for you? Like, Binding of Isaac has co-op, but can it ever live up to, like, GoldenEye co-op with four of your friends on a split screen?
Do you just mean couch multiplayer or, like, cooperative?
Well, I guess that's a good
co-op.
I guess I'm kind of mixing them together. I should say let's stick with cooperative as opposed to like multiplayer stuff. I take it back with the GoldenEye stuff. But what was like one of the first cooperative games that you played that you really, really enjoyed?
So when I was a kid, we'd play. My favorite co-op games were Twisted Metal, which just always like co-op is amazing. You can play through campaign co-op. You can, you know, do PvP, whatever you want. And then Dynasty Warriors, which is sort of the same thing, where, like, any of the modes, just go ahead and play co-op. We're going to do split screen, and you can see your, you know, you run into your friends, and, like, you can, if there's a super hard enemy, you can kind of tag team them. And I don't know if they balanced it, or if they were just like, no, whatever, you know, like, meh, screw it. We're not going to balance it. Just if you want to make it twice as easy, go for it. But I mean, you kind of self-balance. You play harder missions, more challenging things. And that was always really fun. Only rarely did I do, like, the four-player co-op like GoldenEye. And I think that the unfortunate thing is that, you know, as everybody's mostly aware of, the industry's kind of getting a little bit further away from co-op. Even, like, local multiplayer like that. And so it has like a larger effect, an even larger effect than that on the industry, because people don't buy four controllers because there aren't as many couch co-op games coming out. Like, I don't own maybe like PlayStation, maybe like Battle Royale or something, PlayStation All-Stars Battle Royale. I'm just trying to think of a game that I own that it supports up to four local co-op players. So then, because people don't buy controllers, games don't make it four-player co-op. If you're lucky, they make it two-player co-op. And it just sort of has a compounding effect on the industry, which is unfortunate. Because I do think that, you know, I mean, like, all except for Nintendo, and I'm so glad that they just do their own thing with it, because you still got games like Mario Kart and Smash and, what is it, Super Mario 3D World or something like that? Oh, yeah. Whatever, that's sort of this sequel to Super Mario Galaxy series or something like that. And I'm just glad, I don't know, I just have so much goddamn fun. I never played Nintendo as a kid. And I know that, and I even, like, I hate to admit it, but sometimes I was just like, whatever, like, you know, I don't need to play Nintendo. Like, the games I'm playing are, like, more sophisticated or something. And it's so fucking fun. And so I just love that they sort of continue doing that. And I think that's, you know, Smash Brothers. I think that is today what can still kind of capture that four-player GoldenEye feeling.
What I sort of like about Nintendo games, specifically like Super Mario 3D World, New Super Mario Bros., is it seems like Nintendo purposefully made it so that the more people you have, the more of just an absurd mess everything becomes.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
It's like horribly challenging.
Yeah. I agree. It's funny. Yeah, it's like rough around the edges, but, or even in, like, you know, Smash or something like that. Yeah, I love that you can do co-op in the you know, arcade mode missions, whatever. You can do co-op in just like a big battle, but it's not really balanced at all. It's just like if you just sit to the side, not fighting anybody, and just like run away from people, you're probably gonna win.
I think the reason I thought of GoldenEye is it reminded me of Perfect Dark, and Perfect Dark, there was a cooperative multiplayer mode where you could play against AI, and GoldenEye was just like four people, and that was pretty much it. But I remember Perfect Dark, I remember going over to my friend's house, and we would just play couch co-op. And I guess the thing about couch co-op is, maybe it's the nostalgia factor for me. Like, I just remember going over to my friend's house because we wanted to play games. And now, yeah, you can just kind of do it anytime, anywhere, or not anywhere, but with anyone that has an internet connection for a lot of games. And I don't know, it's not quite the same. But I look at something like StarCraft, which has a really fun cooperative mode, which I'm really grateful they added. And I think Blizzard themselves has been pretty straightforward in saying they had no idea that it would be as popular as it's been, and they're going to try to add more to it. And I hope they do in a timely manner.
That's fantastic.
I think there's a huge demand. People want a cooperative mode, because I think there's a lot of people out there, like, multiplayer gets a lot of attention and money because of esports, but I really think that there's a huge customer and consumer demand for things that they can play that are, you know, there's not a lot of stress, it's not a player versus player experience. People want a PvE, player versus environment experience, and when it's cooperative, that's arguably even better. And I just think that's been lacking sorely for a very long time.
It's just more casual, you know what I mean? And it lends itself more to being local, because it's more likely that you'll have people of different skill levels and it's more accessible to people. And I don't know, like, I think there's should be more, you know, people still like to hang out together locally. You know?
Yes, yeah.
Whether they're kids or they're adults who want to, like, knock back a couple of beers and let's play some Mario Kart or something like that. It's super fun. And it just doesn't. I love online co-op. I love online competitive. It's still super fun to do on any given night. But you know, yeah, it's just not. It's never exactly the same as. It's never quite the same as hanging out together and playing.
Mm-hmm. You know, I think the Nintendo games, though, capture that a little bit better. Only because they're pretty much exclusively local co-op. Smash, though, is online now, but.
Yeah.
But that's almost. I mean, it's not exclusively competitive, but it's very much competitive.
Yeah, you know, mostly competitive.
I miss the GameCube actually had a handle so that you could, like, carry it around really easily.
Mm-hmm.
It was very small, and I kind of miss that, because You know, a buddy of mine says last night, dude, bring your Wii U over, and we can, like, play something sometime. And I was like, no, I'm not going to do that.
Yeah, exactly.
The thought of bringing a whole console somewhere is crazy. But, like, back then, you could just pick it up, get all the wires easily, and it's like, bam.
Yep.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. It's too bad that is gone. And then controllers are, like, $70 a piece now. I've only got one controller for each of my systems.
Yeah.
I don't know if they're 70, but they're pricey.
I mean, I think like a big part of it is just—it's just not. There's nothing. There are people that try to recreate it, right? But nothing just feels the same as it used to. I mean, that's just because technology has changed, I suppose.
Yeah.
Mm. Imposter says Keith is giving kids beer.
Mm-hmm. I'm giving. Yeah, it's just there's nothing better than when you
can when you can invite some underage kids over to your house, knock back a few beers.
Hooray!
Yikes!
On the topic of co-op games, one of the co-op experiences I had the most fun with was the original Gears of War on Xbox 360. When it first came out, I think that was one of the earlier online co-op games where you could actually play through the story mode with a friend online. So that was mm-hmm. cool, because I was spending most of my time talking to people like online and stuff back then. And I remember there was this mission where you actually end up splitting off from your teammate, and one person has to control a light while you're, like, walking through this really, really dark place where if you're in the darkness, like, these enemies will attack you, but the light deflects them. And I thought that was the coolest thing, that, like, two people could be doing two totally different things that work with each other. It was,
yeah.
That was just really cool, like, the, how they dole out the tasks. That are just, I don't know, it was really inventive.
Yeah.
So I kind of miss, like, inventive stuff like that. I don't know if that really exists as much
you
anymore.
See some of it with Wii U. Some with a gamepad will do something totally different. But a lot of times they might be at odds with the people playing.
Yeah.
You know, like they try to F them up or something.
Dude.
Yeah. I think we played Nintendo Land. And there's a lot of that in there. Like I kind of saw it when I saw Nintendo Land announced. I thought like, oh, this looks like the stupidest thing. It looks so unfun. And it was really fun.
Yeah,
it's like a super fun party game. We went over to some of our friends' house. We had four people, and one person had the gamepad, and they were kind of like this. So they had like a Luigi's Mansion thing where someone was like, oh, I'm the guy with the gamepad is playing as the ghost. And everybody else is trying to catch him, and he's trying to, like, catch them, and he's invisible. So, I don't know. There's just, I just like that Nintendo will sometimes steer into that kind of thing. I just hope they keep doing it, because the Wii U was not nearly as successful as the Wii was. But, yeah, I hope they continue with that style, because they've always kind of, you know, been like that.
Yeah.
Well, I think what it shows is simple is not only cheaper, but still very popular.
Yeah.
Yep.
Which I think is really, I don't know, it's just an important lesson that I think some companies could stand to learn. Though I think it's also, it's pretty telling that, you know, there's so many popular games now, like this retro, there's, you know, a big like indie and then retro trend, and it just goes to show, like, games can be simple and still very fun. You don't have to be on the cutting edge to enjoy something, which is... or to make something enjoyable. I mean, people want a variety of things, and sometimes you just get home from work and you want something really simple.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it almost seems like gaming as a whole is kind of shifting towards that simplicity.
Yeah.
Like the Assassin's Creed series isn't going to be an annual series anymore, which I think is actually a pretty big deal, because the whole annualized series thing is, like, very clearly just for money. Like, they have no real... they don't really care if it's a quality product. They just want to churn out the name every year.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. That huge franchise doing that to that level is really interesting to me. I feel like it kind of symbolizes a shift in the industry.
Yeah, I agree. Oh, so I see Deltron in the chat. I want to bring this up. I've been playing with Deltron... there's a cooperative custom campaign for StarCraft, and I feel like for someone that, you know, doesn't like StarCraft is immediately off-putting. You're like, well, it's StarCraft, so you don't really think about it again. But I have to say, the big well, number one, like I was saying, it's cooperative, and it is, it's incredible. It's like truly incredible. It's one of the best. It's one of the first off. It's one of the best custom campaigns I've played, and I play a lot of them. But also, it's not really StarCraft. It uses the StarCraft editor. He used the StarCraft editor to make maps, and it's based off of a StarCraft story told from a book that was written actually a while ago. But it's so fun. I don't know how to. I mean, I could describe it in more detail. But the point is somebody used the StarCraft editor to make something just absolutely incredibly fun, and it feels like it was professionally made.
Wow.
And it was just a guy, and he said he's actually going to use it. He wants to apply for some position at Blizzard. Good luck to him. But I guess it's just I would even tell like say to you guys, like I know you like Brett, you didn't really like StarCraft, but you might like these maps because they don't play like StarCraft. They're not RTS. They're
right.
they're just made in StarCraft.
Okay.
But I just wanted to bring that up because you know with viewers and people on my channel, StarCraft related. If you haven't played Shadow of the Xel'Naga, give it a shot. It's really, really, really good.
Do it.
Do it. But I had to bring that up and suck that campaign's dick just for a moment because I've had so much fun playing with Deltron.
Suck it!
Yeah, suck it. So he brings up a good point. There's 7 maps, and each map is based off of a different genre. So the last map is RTS.
Okay.
But all the other maps are not RTS at all. There's no base building until the last map. But like Mission 2 was based off of like a Resident Evil point and click adventure where, and it's cooperative, keep in mind. So like I would walk around and I had an inventory and I could mix together different things. I had a limited inventory space and I could mix together different items to make things. And then Deltron was playing this little robot that could build things and mine minerals. And he would like salvage things and items would pop out and I'd have to pick them up and combine them with things that could make a weapon that I could install into his little robot character, and then he would use those to attack an enemy. And it was like, it was just a really fun thing that was in StarCraft, and it really captured something so fun. And I thought it was cool how each mission was like a different genre. There was a MOBA one, there was a stealth-related one. It was all neat, very neat.
That's really cool.
Very nice.
Yeah. But and it's, I mean, it was co-op. That's the other thing, too, is if it was just, like, single player, they would have been really well made, and you can play them single player, but I think the best part about it was that the cooperative element of it, and being on Skype and being able to chat about it, and I'm just trying to find a way to make sure this fits in with our theme.
Oh, yeah.
Brett's getting his ass kicked in Bloodborne.
Nice. Yep.
I am.
Oh, so Dark Souls. What about Dark Souls with cooperative? Isn't that a big part of the game where you can like summon in people?
Yeah, I love that. It's pretty. I mean, it's really unique the way they do it. And I kind of. It seems like the later they get in the series, and we'll see what they do with Dark Souls 3, because they did it in Bloodborne, where you can. Kind of like, yeah, okay, by the end of it, they've patched it. It used to be like you had to be within a certain level range or something. Now, anybody can summon anybody of any range, and it tries to like scale them down to your level so it's easier to play with friends. You can type a password into this, you know, object in-game, and then they can type the password into their object, and then you have a much higher likelihood of summoning them. So they're really trying to boost that. Whereas before, they really didn't. They sort of wanted you to play with strangers, and it was not intended that you play with your friends. Now, there were ways that you could accomplish that anyway, like Brett and I would play online together with the original Dark Souls. We did that several times. But it was not intended, and it was not easy. So it was kind of cool when we could accomplish it. It was like, I mean, because we both independently loved the games, and we're like, oh my god, we get to play together. Like, this is crazy. Well, you know.
Yeah.
But even then, you know, once you beat the boss, they go away. And so they're moving more and more towards being able to deliberately do co-op with people that you know in real life. But there are some negative side effects from that. Like, people can summon several people that they know. I mean, they can do it with strangers, too. It's just less likely. And they'll just camp out in a major PvP area waiting for someone to invade and then kick the crap out of them. I always sort of liked that it was a little anonymous in that, okay, yeah, you can ring your bell and you can summon a friend. They do this in Bloodborne. You can ring your bell and you can summon a friend, but you also, by doing that, open yourself up to summoning an enemy, like a random person who is going to try to kill you. And I think that's pretty awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And I love watching people online complain about it, and they say stuff like, I'm having trouble on this boss, and I should be able to summon my friend without getting. I have to turn the internet on and then I can get invaded, and it's bullshit. And I'm just like, I love it. I love it that they force you to do that. Like, yeah, you can get some help. You can get some help from the internet. Yeah, you want someone to come and help you? Yeah, but someone's gonna also invade your game and try to hunt you down. I think that's just amazingly brutal.
Yeah. It's so cool. Like, there's no just, like, I only want help. You just have to kind of open yourself up to the...
I know.
The malicious outside. I remember you used to stream. You used to stream invading other people, didn't you?
Yeah, so I was a dick because we... because they used to do it in the first Dark Souls. They did it by soul level. And Brett and I would do soul level one runs of the game because it was possible to beat the game. You didn't get the ability to invade until, like, three quarters of the way through the game. And so Brett and I would do soul level one runs of the game where we never leveled up the whole time. But you can still get items like, oh, yeah, if you enchant it with fire, then it loses the normal. I mean, then it just does raw damage. It doesn't scale with your ability. And so we would use, like, one of the starting weapons in the game, like the hand axe. And then we would enchant it with lightning up to, you know, plus six or something, and it didn't raise your physical requirements. And we'd, like, sprint past all the hard enemies in the game and, like, grab a really awesome shield and just book it. Because we knew where everything was. And then we'd go back to, like, one of the early areas in the game and we'd invade people. And so they're just... Oh, it was so awful in retrospect, but like there'd just be these like confused people just kind of jogging through the game, and just kind of like looking around and like kind of like poking at enemies and trying to figure it out, and then we'd come in like fully decked out, and the most fun part was kind of like just fucking with them, you know.
I mean, the important thing is you had to work really hard.
Yeah, because you wouldn't kill them right away. Yeah, you had to work really hard to get the ability to fuck with people. And so you wouldn't kill them right away. You just kind of like lead them along and just kind of run around and do goofy stuff or try to like figure out ways to like sick enemies on them or like trick them into doing dumb stuff. And or like you try to like wait until you see them somewhere and just like run up and kick them into a pit. It's just dumb shit like that. It's real fun.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that's Dark Souls.
But it's super creative. I love I loved the randomness of the co-op and the fact that you can, it's not matchmaking exact in the traditional sense. You find signs on the ground and they come in and they're like a spirit. You find hints that people leave you on the ground and you can rate up their hint, which will make it more likely to appear. And if you rate up their hint, then they get healed for it. So they've got all these incentives in place to get people to participate. You earn in-game things. I mean, you earn rewards from the single-player game by completing these multiplayer objectives. Like, you can level up in the it's not the Dark Brotherhood, but I don't remember what it's called. So, like, in these different factions and get new items and stuff like that. And I think that's really cool. It's all very integrated in a single-player game. Super immersive in that way. Except for, like, it'll say, like, you know, XXX420 Blaze Star invaded your game and stuff like that. And then you're like, all right.
Welcome.
So, something about that that feeling that's got, I mean, even if you're like super leveled up, when you see like that thing pop up that says the XXX whoever has invaded your game, you're just like, oh fuck. Like,
yeah,
at any moment they
react.
Could pop out.
Yeah, you're like, oh god. And you're just like, look around. If you don't see him, like, you try to find a hiding spot, or, like, finish off the enemies you're fighting, and like, but they can see like kind of how far you've gotten, because it's sort of methodical. So if all the enemies are dead up to a certain point, and then they, like, all the enemies are dead, and then you see the next area is still populated, and you just start looking around, and you're like, where is that little fucker?
Wow, I never knew about this little cheese spot.
Yep. Yeah,
that's probably the best co-op experience, like, playing that Dark Souls with you so long ago. Oh my gosh.
Ugh.
And we would stream it and have a whole bunch of people watching us.
Yeah.
What a thrill.
What a thrill. Thrills and chills.
I guess overall, I just wish there was more. Like, I mean, it's just my own preferences, right? But I just really wish there was more. I mean, I just want every game that I play to have some sort of fun co-op. And it doesn't have to be couch co-op, but I kind of just like co-op for AI. And I think a lot of people do, and it's like slightly ignored in some ways. I don't know.
Yeah. I think so as well. And obviously, you know, as like streamers and YouTubers and that kind of thing, it appeals even more. I mean, the online stuff and everything appeals even more to us because it's just so, I mean, because obviously you're interested in games as it pertains to the community. So, of course, you're going to want to play with your friends or even or strangers or whatever, meet people, make new friends. Obviously, MOBAs kind of bring people together in a way that they never have been, like five people. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can do, I guess you could probably do that in like Call of Duty and stuff like that. But yeah, you know, you kind of bring five people together in such a way and to really be successful, you should all be over voice chat. And that's super fun and a pretty new thing. So I like that.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
I like
that. Oh yes.
Well, hey, it's a good co-op discussion. I'd love to hear some people give some examples of maybe some unknown co-op games that we haven't heard of. So the anecdote for tonight, suggested by Brett, possibly when he was drunk, was tell some funny drunk stories.
Oh, God.
So Brett, let's start with you.
Start with me. Oh, I was like, oh God, what am I gonna say that's not gonna totally ruin my reputation? But I thought of something that's really good, and so it's actually quite fitting for the DPS podcast, and you'll find out why. So it was my 22nd birthday, I think. Yeah, that sounds right. We'll just go with 22nd. It doesn't really matter, and we were just having a great time, and obviously I was drinking a lot and whatever, and so I got a ride home from this girl who I went to high school with, and I sat in the back seat because there was somebody else in the car too, and I was like, oh, thank you so much for the drive home. It was really nice of you, blah, blah, blah. Pretty typical stuff. Went to bed safely, which was nice. Then I wake up, and I'm just like, you know, I'm just like stretching, and I'm scratching myself, and I like, and I feel this goop ass shit on my underpants. Like on
the, oh God.
I felt like this disgusting thing, and I look back and I was like, oh my God, I think I shit my pants.
Oh no.
And so I'm like inspecting it. I'm like looking, I'm like, how would I shit my pants and it would end up on the outside of my underpants? And so I'm looking at it more and more, and I find out that I fucking sat on a milk dud on the way home. And it freaked me out. I've never been so sobered after like an awful hangover. I was like, holy shit.
That could have been a lot worse.
Yeah, yeah. So that freaked me out. I was like, oh my God. But yeah, I don't know. That's a pretty good one for me. There's other stories, but...
Is it wrong that I sort of wish that you had just pooped your pants for the sake of a slightly funnier story?
Ugh. That would be the worst. I don't know if I'd ever drink again if I actually shit my pants. That's just terrible.
Yep.
Alright. I'll go next. I'm eating something. Sorry. But I'm just going to preemptively... say, Justin, that I don't want to hear any... I don't want your story to be a story about me, because no, I'm going to tell a story about me.
I won't tell anything that involves you, Keith.
I don't need my shenanigans to be a matter of public record.
I respect you enough to have known that in advance.
All right, so what I got is... because mine's already stupid enough, but I, like... See, this doesn't really happen anymore because you don't drink as much and you know how to hold your alcohol in a way that you don't, because that's the really killer part, is that like the more alcohol that you drink, the better you feel and the more you want to drink. But there's really a point, you know, that is related to the number that you've had and the alcohol content, where you're not going to feel better beyond that. You should just stop, because it's only going to get worse.
Yep.
And you don't really know that. So it was back when I started, and I was I was at a party, but it was just a small group of friends. It was like it wasn't in high school, but it was high school friends from high school. So it was everybody was back home. We were down in the basement hanging out, and I decided that, like, people were like showing off and like trying to do the kick up from the legs thing on the floor. So where like you, like the Jackie Chan, you know, you're laying on your back and then you like kick up. And at the time I had never done that, but I just decided like, I can definitely do that. I'm definitely going to be real good at that. And so I really went for it. And it was like, and I just totally like, my legs just, so I like shot up in the air and my legs just kind of went straight out in front of me, and I just landed right on my tailbone really, really hard.
Oh, God.
And it was one of those floors that it's like carpet, so it kind of feels soft, but like it's like an inch of carpet, and then below that it's just concrete. Oh. So you do not have anything to break your fall. And so it was sort of the point where I was like, oh, this really hurts. I'm like pretty drunk and this still really, really hurts.
Yeah.
And the next day I went home the next day and it just hurt so bad. It bruised so bad. And I was like, you know, I was home back in my hometown, so I was staying with my parents. And so I just like, just sort of like walking in the door like, I'm just like, I just got to get up to my room and just lay down, because I'm just like walking with my hand like on my back like an old man. So I walked. I'm like, oh, hey, yeah, I'm doing all right. I'm doing all right. It was fun. It was fun. I just kind of like slowly walk up the stairs to my room and just lay down in bed and try to like recover.
Oh, God. Just thinking about that. Oh, dear.
Tailbone. Ugh.
And it you said it exactly. You're like, I'm drunk and this still hurts.
Yeah, this is going to really, really hurt tomorrow. This must hurt a lot because it still hurts.
drinking.
I remember there was one time before I was moving. I think I was I don't know. I don't remember, but I was moving to a new apartment the next day. And I went to this girl's house with a bunch of, she was having a party. It was like the day after a party that they held. So they had a ton of leftover stuff, and they had like a bunch, they had made Jello shots with 151 rum in them. And if you're unfamiliar with 151, it just means it's called that because it's 151 proof. Mm-hmm. It's bad news.
That's
so,
that's a lot.
It was so much fun. But I will say that now, I don't think I could... I can't even eat normal Jell-O, because the thought of it just makes me horribly, horribly sick. Just thinking about eating Jell-O and having it, like, slide down my throat and just remembering what... like, how sick I was after that. So I was at this girl's house, and at one point, I just sort of looked around, and I had a bad habit of doing this when I was drunk. I would look around and just think, like, why am I still here? And most of the time I wouldn't go anywhere, but in this specific instance I was already outside. We were like outside at like a bonfire they had, so I just got up and just left. And the girl's house that we were at, she's like, Justin, where are you going? And I looked at her and I just shrugged and then I just walked away. And I made it like 6 or 7 blocks. Keith, if you remember where that Wendy's was. Mm-hmm. I was like 4 or 5 blocks north of campus, like north of that CVS, and I made it to Wendy's, and I made it to Wendy's, and then I looked around, I'm like, I'm so far from home right now, because we drove there, we did not walk to get there, and so I just, I, I, I called my roommate. I sat down on the sidewalk with my legs crossed and just said, I'm lost. Will you please come and get me? I was not lost. I knew exactly where I was, but I just remember distinctly saying, I'm lost. Please come and take me home. And then he came and got me, and we went home. And then all of our stuff was already packed up, except I was sleeping on an air mattress, and I just remember vomiting like all over the floor. I was really good with my vomit. All right. I usually could control it. I'd always go to the bathroom. This was the one time where it was just all over the floor. And just, it was bad. And then I was hungover. And then the next day I had to move in to where I was moving and was hungover the whole day.
Ugh.
And that, yeah, ugh. So I don't drink that much anymore. But I mean, everyone in college, if you were drinking in college, probably has a story like that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And, oh my God.
Every night that you go out drinking, there's at least one thing you could probably say about it. It's like, yep, that, yeah, shit.
Man. And the other thing, without giving any specific examples, Halloween is always the worst.
Yes.
because people drink more than usual on Halloween, and you're in a really stupid costume. So it's always the worst.
I like the, and you're in a really stupid costume.
Uh-huh.
It's true.
Doesn't help.
I there was Green Man. So, yeah, I would love to tell a story
about
Green Man.
Yeah, that was the best.
Yeah, so Keith dressed up as Green Man, and in college, we all wanted to be like Keith, because Keith wasn't as really cool. So I'm like, well, I'm going to be Green Man, too.
Justin, we planned Green Man together.
Well, you were the one that found Green Man, and then I hopped on the bandwagon of Green Man. But I just wanted to make sure you got credit for doing Green Man originally.
Oh, thanks.
So
well, I guess it's always Sonny did it originally, but
true, yes.
We were the first to steal it, I'll tell you that much. Now you see him at every now you see people in morph suits at every goddamn football game.
If you're unfamiliar with Green Man, it's just a full-body green spandex suit that covers your entire body, including your face.
With no holes.
No holes. It's just green
anywhere
over your whole body and face. And it doesn't hide anything. It's just green spandex. And so Keith and I dressed up, and we went to a few parties. And in a few of those, we definitely didn't know whose parties we were at. But sometimes we would just walk in, and everyone would be like, oh, it's Green Man! And we would just start dancing. And I distinctly remember I was dancing, and we came in. It was like a few of us and a few of our friends, and we were dancing. And then it's kind of like a nightmare because you're dancing. You can't see anything, and you're just kind of flailing around, and people are just sort of shoving you around because you just assume you're probably getting in people's faces and stuff because you can't see what you're doing. You can't see where you are. It was a Halloween party, and the lights are like flashing, and you can't see anything. So I remember, like, it gets really hot, so I go to take the hood off, and I'm in an entirely different part of the house, and none of my friends are anywhere. And I don't know how I ended up there, but I was just in an entirely different space of the house.
You just start dancing, and your mask's covered, you can't see anything except for, like, flashing lights, and you can kind of barely breathe in the thing. And then every time, you would finally take it off, and there'd be, like a group of people around you, like, cheering, like, yeah! And, like,
Green
yeah,
Man!
And you're like, where are my friends? Where am I?
That was so fun, though.
Oh, that costume was a winner.
Those were the days. For our 21st birthday parties, we made real, I mean, jungle juice. Whatever you would consider real. We didn't real skimp out, though. We bought, like, real fruit.
Yeah. Yeah, a bunch of, you know, it wasn't just like vodka and Hawaiian punch, which we did a lot as well, but it was like, I mean, it was like a million different kinds of liquor and then tons of fruit and juice, like real juice and all kinds of stuff in there. It was delicious.
Yeah,
we had like a big party and then, I mean, maybe half of it was gone. So then the next weekend we had more people over. At, like, the next night we did, and then they're like, yes, I mean, still there. And it would come over, and it was just, like, sitting out in a vat. Like, if you were lucky, it was, like, covered with a lid. It was a big vat just kind of sitting in our kitchen and with, like, fruit and stuff floating in it. But we're like, oh, there's enough alcohol in there.
It's still good, man.
Kill a kid. It's still good.
I wanted to, when we moved here, I really wanted to have a college party. Like, it would just be called, like, there'd be an invitation to Facebook just called college party. And what I wanted it to be was just, like, only have Natty Light. There'd be, like, there had to have been, like, 3 cases of Natty Light and then 1 case of Budweiser. And nobody was allowed to drink the Budweiser. It would just sit in the fridge and be like, oh, that's only for the people that live here. But it had to be in the fridge. And then there needed to be just a big vat of unidentifiable red alcoholic liquid.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just like it doesn't even have to be alcohol in there, but it needs to be just Hawaiian Punch or Kool-Aid, and just put like Kamchatka vodka in it from like the plastic bottle. And then there needs to be a ladle on the floor next to it with like hairs and stuff floating. And that is a college party.
There's like red Solo cups. And they're all over the house. There's like a cornhole board.
Yes.
And then every time we'll be waiting there as, you know, the host or whatever, and we'll like welcome people in and we'll be like, hey, what's your major? Hey, what's your major?
Hey, who do you know here?
Yeah, who do you know here?
But I don't think anybody was that interested in doing that. So unfortunately, I really, really wanted to do that just because it'd be hilarious. But then I also realized that nobody would enjoy themselves.
Yeah, we should just do that now. It'd be funnier.
Yeah.
Wait until you're like 40 and then do it.
Let's do it.
I feel like there's bound to be like a bunch of other stupid stories that we have, but I can't really think of any, can't think of many more right now.
Oh, I can think of some. I'm choosing not to say.
That's fair. That's absolutely fair. Cool. Well, this was a fun podcast.
I will say one more thing is like our RA in college was like the best. I think there were some like, and they're just, you know, doing their jobs, like they're accountable for it at the end of the day. So if they were bad, like you couldn't really hold it against them. But our RA was super, super nice. And it was just sort of the thing where, you know, there'd be like wine and stuff like that. And, you know, there'd be like wine or beer or something. And she would just like, the door would just be open and we'd be like watching Requiem for a Dream or playing World of Warcraft or something, and she'd just kind of walk back and be like, God damn it, guys. What the hell? You know, like, close the door. Or like, Jesus.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, Deltron's talking about beer pong. I don't know. Some people took it, like, really seriously, but I always had fun playing it, but some people were, like, crazy, crazy into it.
Make up rules as they go.
Yeah.
Oh, you can take out the ball if it's rolling around, if it's spinning around the top 2 inches of the cup, and if it's below the 2 inches but it's still rolling, you can't pull it out. But if it bounces 3 times off the table, you do have one chance to make it. It's like,
I'm exhausted just thinking about the rest of these rules.
These balls.
I'm just gonna throw it. All right.
Cool. Well, fun podcast, guys. I look forward to seeing you next week.
Can't wait.
Me neither.
Goodbye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.